faction most of the time.
A faction's useful. Let's see. Now for some overview of the world that you would know about. Most people are aware that about 6,000 years ago, there was this horrific event worldwide that is known as the Sundering. There were great empires back then, great magical empires, and something happened that essentially broke the world, and it was the equivalent of Fallout, except magic-wise. So you go from this great magical, like, you know, magical landscape with all sorts of things happening, and all of a sudden, magic has essentially destroyed the world, turned into a wasteland, caused continents to rearrange themselves. Kind of like the spell plague, except it lasted longer. It lasted approximately 1,000 years. And it is said that the divine light, which we'll get to in a moment, spoke to a follower and told them to build temples to basically stop the world shifting. And it did. And that was 5,000 years ago. Now that I mentioned the divine light, let me give you a quick overview on the four major deities that belong solely to this world. The first of which is the divine light. However, nobody actually knows who the divine light is. They just refer to it as the divine light. However, everyone believes that the divine light is actually some god in one of the pantheons. Whether it's the Ollaras pantheon alone or any of the other ones, you know, people have ventured like Pelor or Bahamut. And for a while, there was even a devoted following on this world to the next god I will tell you about, the goddess of water, and also linked with life and rebirth, Woos. For a while, especially in Meeg, up until about just under 2,000 years ago, there was the major religion in the region basically stated that Woos, the goddess of water, was also the goddess of life and the divine light, basically. You know, one true god to worship, blah, blah, blah. All the other gods are, like, you know, minor things. And they held her up as the, you know, supreme deity. And had spread a huge empire across Meeg and all the way down through the southern continent of Eberus. And throughout the islands and all that in this region. There's a lot of water in the way of getting to other continents. Like, pretty much there's two major continents in this region. But, you know, water on either side has prevented a lot of transfer to elsewhere. And now they are sitting on top of my notes. Okay. Thankfully I have my other notes on one note on my third computer screen. But Woos no longer is worshipped except maybe in cults as the divine light. She's just been returned to her original state as the goddess of water. This is a goddess that your character, Lobu, would be very familiar with. Where you came from, I imagine that Woos is depicted as one of your own people, a beautiful, radiant sea elf. And she would be, you know, thought of as a mother goddess, possibly, to your people. You know, goddess of water, goddess of oceans, you know, she would protect and watch over you.
Nice. Yeah, I'll adjust my backstory to suit.
Yeah. I mean, there are other gods that your people might have worshipped, but she, here on Ollaras, she would have been a major one. The next major deity is someone that is only known here in Ollaras, but is actually a really big deal. For some reason, she hasn't spread her influence beyond Ollaras. There are theories to this, but, you know, most people in Ollaras are aware of her. And that is Eum, the goddess of nightmares. Some think that she is the mother of demons and possibly the sentient manifestation of the abyss itself. These are just theories that people have put forth about her. But for some reason, she is only known on Ollaras because there have been, like, you know, travelers from other worlds who occasionally show up. And they haven't heard of her. And now the last of these four specific to Ollaras, who is probably one of the more important ones, is Quer, the goddess of death. She would be the protector of souls and all of that. The people in Ollaras probably wouldn't know about the Raven Queen because they, as far as they're concerned, Quare is the one that protects and guides souls and, you know, keeps them from harm after somebody dies. Making sure that they go where they're supposed to go instead of being, like, you know, interrupted or stolen in the middle of things. But, she also has a demiplane that's said to sit on a gateway between the abyss, the nine hells, and the celestial plane. That she basically has influence over anything that steps into there, and she can, like, you know, force them to conform to her will and her view, or be cast out from that particular plane, which, you know, is a very important thing for her. But usually when people, you know, die, one of the major blessings is, like, you know, Quare be with them, or something along those lines. Because she is, again, the one who protects the dead once they die, the goddess of death. And so you want, you know, somebody's soul to be protected. And that's about it for the major unique deities to this world. Ready for some more history?
Absolutely.
Note taken.
All right. So, you know about the Sundering, you know about 5,000 years ago. Now, the important parts for things going on here in Meek. Before that time, during the 1,000 years of the Sundering, magic was essentially banished or, you know, forbidden by most cultures. Dragons were hunted down to near extinction. Any dragon races at the time, like, there were some other dragon races that existed that were, like, you know, more humanoid-sized. Not necessarily humanoid, but, like, you know, kind of human-sized sentient beings. They were essentially annihilated, or at least believed to be, since this is what we know from this side of the world. Other races have gone completely extinct. There was supposedly, like, a sentient race of griffins that were more people-like instead of animal-like. That people still occasionally find statues for that have, you know, since vanished. During that time, there were also people that, you know, with magic that fought back and used, you know, created Warforged at the time. So Warforged were a thing at the time, but they have mostly gone away too. Nobody has seen one in a long time, at least not in this region. It's believed that there was a lot of other high magic that's simply been lost, forgotten, and that those that had it either died out or, you know, went traveling across the multiverse, never to return to this world. So after 5,000 years ago, in addition to the other races that were wiped, that were nearly wiped out, at the time, Minotaurs were also being hunted to extinction. Most people don't know exactly why. That there are some theories that they were in charge, originally had a really amazing civilization. And some people blame that civilization for the Sundering, and as a result, they started hunting the Minotaurs down and killing all but the dumbest and most brutal of them. So they kind of, like, changed the landscape of the Minotaur race all together on this world. Not long after sometimes I have a hard time pronouncing the words that I've written down. Milam civilization started taking root. They were the ones that worshipped Wus as the divine light. They were a mixed culture of both humans and lizard folk. This is well known at the time that there was just a joining of the two races together. In fact, the statues of Wus from that time period that you might find occasionally in shrines up here on land, that are mostly defunct at this point, depict Wus as a four-armed lizard woman with humanoid hair and breasts. So they know that that's from that region, that time period. But they were you know, they were slavers. They enslaved what was left of the Minotaur race. They enslaved other races around them. Dwarves, halflings, gnomes, etc. Elves, and they, you know, they had a campaign against the elves for a while, like, you know, killing elves off, or, you know, there would be half-elves, of course, like, you know, the half-elves would be okay, and, you know, orcs, again, enslaved, or, you know, killed off, depending. So, a lot of the land, like, a lot of the Meeg region was, like, you know, conquered by all of them, and they, you know, brought their civilization down south. But they were like road builders. They, in some ways, they were a lot like the Romans. So they built roads, they built outposts. There's a lot of leftover, you know, cities or state, you know, capital cities that have old architecture in them that was from that time period. But that that civilization died about 2,000 years ago. After infighting, after slave rebellions, and there's been a lot of other, you know, kingdoms since then, some more empires, and a lot of other stuff. As I said, I mostly spent a lot of my time studying the Everest region, which was down south of this Meeg, so I'm more excited to, you know, start thinking about what's going on up here in this region, and getting to explore that with new players. So, yay! Any questions so far?
Would you mind putting the spelling of the, like, the road building society, that culture.
Dude, you don't even want to see how I'm spelling these things.
I'm occasionally writing them down. I'm a terrible speller myself. Back and forth for a while as to whether this region was called Milam and the society was Meeg, or if this area was Meeg and the society was Milam. I've got it written down both ways in my notes, but I decided, like, okay, once and for all, it is Meeg. This continent is Meeg.
Just having it both ways, a mess.
Yeah. So that's what happens when you're bad with spelling. Hi, Vax. Hear you. Sweet little guy. Adopted him over Memorial Day. Nice Memorial Day weekend. I spent the first week here quarantined in my home office.
What kind of cat is he?
Oh, he's a...
Ooh.
Let's see, where is my general chat? General, I will post a picture of him in general chat. Oops. That's my Sims screenshot. I don't need those right now. Pictures. There he is. Taking a nap on my chest at one point. He's a sweet little guy.
Please tell him I love him. Oh my god.
Yeah. He keeps sneezing though. I keep wondering if it's like, you know, for a while I thought he had a cold, but, you know, he seems fine otherwise, and he's running around, so I'm guessing it's allergies. I need to find that out when I take him for his vet checkup. Right now, Mira has to go to her vet checkup for her yearly shot. Hopefully she'll still be as cool with the vet as she has always been. My first cat as a kid, she used to throw fits every time she went to the vet. She would, like, growl at them, she'd hiss at them, she'd be very upset. Mira, on the other hand, she might not like going into the carrier, she might not, you know, like the card ride, but she was cool as everything with the vets. She's like, yeah. Purr, 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 purr. Oh, you're taking my temperature. Okay, that's fine. Oh, you're giving me a shot. Okay, that's fine.
I mean, she's good with them. My cat gives everyone absolute hell. Like,
yeah,
Buddy, this is for your own good.
Yeah, I don't know how Vax is going to respond yet. He's an unknown. I don't know if he's going to be sweet like her, or if he's going to act like my old cat who hated vets. But at least the condo I moved into, the vet is actually down the street from me. So it shouldn't be too hard to get to and back. So the first event I had, just for, you know, a session zero sort of thing, was that I know that Lobu, you had something interesting in your backstory. This will take place about a day or two after you finally made it to land, and are not sure what exactly to do with yourself. You've learned that you're in a place called Salt Marsh. You've learned vaguely that it is the south of the country of Keoland. You don't know much else. Sorry, my voice connector just went to red. Do you guys still hear me?
Yep,
give your second.
But you don't know much else other than that, and people have been giving you strange looks because you're, like, the only sea elf in the area. And this area is mainly human, although you have seen a handful of dwarves who seem to be also fairly new in town. And at what point you even spotted a tiefling on the deck of a ship. But for the most part, humans and some half-elves. So that...
I think at this point, he's just, like, equally awed by everybody. Just, like, wide eyes, a lot of, hey, how's it going? How are you? Sort of, kind of, like, jovial about it, but kind of confused.
And you also see the occasional gnome as well. Some of the humans have been giving a wide berth. However, you have met a dwarven woman. She seems pretty jovial as well. Who's introduced herself to you as Menestrad Carperlox. And you know, you've learned that she is the leader of this local miners' guild. That has, you know, basically come to town recently to do some interesting mining. So, it's always nice to see a new face around here, not just a wash with humans everywhere. You're new in town, yes?
Yeah, brand new. Just came out of the sea.
Well, you look it. I don't think I've really seen any of your kind before, but you're a sea elf, right? I think I've heard of you.
Yeah, just kind of new, kind of can't be with my people anymore, but it's all good. We're gonna figure it out. It's nice to meet you. I'm very confused about all the people around. Are you a dwarf?
Yeah. Menestrad Carperlox, that's my name. And it's
very.
Always good to see someone else that's curious. Curiosity and hard work are some of my main traits. So, what are you curious about? What can I help you with?
Trying to figure out how to make some money around here and how to be useful. How to be useful for other people.
Well, I don't know about you being useful at the moment. No offense, but you don't look like you're the type that would be good with mining. However, if you're wondering what all the people are doing out here right now, here on the docks today, they're getting set up for the festival tomorrow. I imagine that there'll be some competitions you might be able to find more of your speed.
Yeah. Do they do music around here? Do they do music on the surface land?
Well, of course, there's always music. What, do you play an instrument? Do you sing?
More the instrument side of things, but yeah. And then he pulls out his little concertina accordion and plays a few.
Roll performance check. She kind of nods her head. Nods her head and grins wildly. Well, if you play around the festival tomorrow, I'm sure you're going to get some good money from that. I mean, some of my people who doubt the mines, they're going to want to come in and listen. They're going to want to come in and play some of the games. Maybe do some arm wrestling. Do you arm wrestle? You don't look strong enough, but who knows? Maybe you're more wildly than you look.
I'm willing to give anything a shot.
Well, I imagine me and my people are going to be cleaned up at the arm wrestling tournament. I imagine there's other stuff for you. There's supposed to be some good stuff at the festival. It might be a small village, but we take our festival with pride.
I'm always down for a good festival.
Excellent. Good to know. Well, see you around, Sealf.
Bye, Copperlocks.
No, I. Okay. I'm still coming up with specifics, if that makes sense.
Yeah. I found that, at least with my NPCs, that, you know, I might, you know, come up with a character concept, write it down, and then find as I'm role playing them that they're not the same.
No, yeah.
So it's like, you know, at the time it's like, I'll write, okay, hot-tempered. And no, they usually end up being cool as cucumber. And then I'll write for the opposite for somebody else, and it's like, no, they get reckless and angry. So it's like,
exactly.
They always tell me what they're about. They don't. I don't tell them. I try to tell them, and then they tell me different later. Sometimes.
I was originally, Lobu's original character design and, like, concept made him very broody. And this still, like, got some scars, but, like, completely the opposite. He just doesn't have enough muscle to go around being a grump all the time, really.
Yep, sometimes you want to play the brooder, and it turns out, no, they're life of the party. Other times you want to play the happy dude, nope, they're brooding all the time. Your character doesn't tell you who they are. Little guy, you don't want it to fall on you. Oh, sweet little guy. He's in my he settled into my arms just like in that picture.
Oh. Really glad that you let us reroll below and
yeah.
I was thinking of how I was gonna play a low intelligence, I was like,
Is that your dumpstat there?
Yeah.
Can you hear the purring?
Not quite.
Yeah, I guess it's not as loud as some of the other cats.
Oh!
There it is.
Yeah, I pulled the microphone down right in front of his face, and then he forced me to bite it, so. Still won't wear his collar. He kind of a nice little collar. Mostly so that I can hear him when he's walking around, because he is so quiet and stealthy that I just, which is why he's aptly named.
Vax, yeah.
Yeah. But, well, I looked at him in the thing, it's like, yeah, he's gonna be Vaxeldon. And then as soon as I get him home, he's very stealthy, he pounces things, he's very affectionate, it's like, yeah, he's perfectly named. I'm terrible with names, like I said, so it's like I'll take inspiration from anywhere. But, yeah. But yeah, he won't wear his collar, even though I've accidentally stepped on him a few times. Because he likes to, you know, sneak behind me and thread through my legs when I'm not looking.
In terms of backstory?
In terms of anything, you said half park barbarian, and I thought I saw sailor background at one point.
Sailor, I was thinking maybe that basically, I'm sorry, I'm trying to do multiple things with my character sheet right now.
That's okay.
In terms of like background and herself, she's a very large half orc. Not brutish necessarily, but still kind of put people off when she talks. She's, you know, she's charismatic, but not kind, if that makes sense.
Brutally honest. Would she be described as brutally honest?
Sure, that's probably a good descriptor. I can find
it. Doesn't sugarcoat it for people, like, so that comes off as me. Like, I have in his game a very pragmatic gunslinger kobold who might come off as being mean, but she's like, you know, like, this is what we did back home. When people misbehave, they get fed to the dragon. There's no negotiation about it. The dragon eats them.
The great thing about Flint, her character she's talking about, is like the second any NPC treats her right, it's like not a problem, easy street, everything's going pretty well. But like, yeah, don't put up with any bullshit.
from other characters who can, you know, do that otherwise, but yeah.
Let's just say be a little intense.
Yeah. Vax, don't bite me. I know my chin might taste good, but you don't want to chew on that. He also likes to steal my glasses off my face.
By the way, I think I took this weird spell from that water spell document I sent you.
Which one?
I think Luck of the Sea. And I think that's probably how I eventually get on a ship, is trying to ingratiate myself with that particular little trick.
Okay, so if this all I was thinking of, a crew before that had been attacked and killed by pirates. I know it's pretty basic, but she's on a search for.
So that means you would have knowledge of the Sea Princes, who are the local pirates in the area. They have been known to frequent this coast, along with the islands out to the west. You'd probably be aware of them, and if you have a thing out for them, for pirates in general, they'd probably be on your shit list.
Sure, absolutely.
And I imagine that you would not like anybody who you find out is associated with them, either.
No, not at all.
Good to know.
Yeah, and then I figured... Oh, I'm right now looking for maybe a new group to head onto the water with. If that makes, like, a new crew, new people.
A new ship.
New ship. Yep.
Alright. So, half-orc, and in this place where you mostly see humans and the occasional dwarf, and maybe a gnome here and there, you'd probably find it to be unusual to see himself off on his own.
Hey, how's it going? How you doing?
I'm doing great. How are you, my friend?
Just trying to make a living, you know?
What brings you to the land?
Well, let's just put it that my people don't want me there anymore, and they consider me cursed.
Oh, wow, you're very honest. People consider you cursed, what is that?
Don't worry about it. It's probably a bunch of superstition or something, I don't know.
How have you found it being, I'm looking seems that we might be some of the odd ones out.
I think I missed a little bit of what you said.
Looking around, there aren't many, here. how does it feel? Have you been treated well? I mean, I'm truly just curious.
Have I been treated well? How long is this, like, same day?
Yeah, it's the same day. Basically, you arrived in the morning, it's getting towards the afternoon or evening now. Mostly you've just gotten weird looks. Carpalox is the only one that really spoke much to you. Most people, they make a hi or nod, or they'll just, like, you know, step across the street to avoid you. They haven't, come out and be vicious or anything like that. They've just kind of been... The humans around here have mostly been, you know, ignoring you.
People are great. there are some people that do, like, this thing called mining, which I think is swimming, but in dirt. And that sounds pretty...
Yeah. Great. So, I don't mean to interrupt you, I really don't, but can we please go back to that curse thing?
If you insist.
I mean, yes.
you come across a giant sea monster one time, and suddenly everyone's spooked out by you.
So that's your crime. You came across a sea monster.
Yep, that's probably all.
Right.
Look, I'm trying to find some work, and you know, you seem all right. You wanna hit the docks, see what we can work.
I'm looking for work together.
Yeah, you seem good.
I'm sure you're fine. I'm sure the sea monster didn't do anything.
It's totally cool. Look, just I'm a little strange, but I'm trying to make friends.
Sorry, my cat has decided to
start to eat my mic. It sounded like he was trying to eat your mic a little bit.
In fact, you seem to be in the newer section of the docks, as it becomes clear looking around that the docks have actually undergone a series of expansions lately. It looks like, you know, there are two primary piers used to load and unload larger vessels, along with a bunch of smaller ones for the fishing vessels and the like. The two primary piers do look fairly new. They were built in the last month or two. Okay, now my cat is laying on the book right where I was reading. But, yeah, it looks like, commerce is getting more and more intense around here. They've expanded and, you know, driving more people in. There's a few new warehouse and house-looking buildings around. And there's even off in the distance, well, not too far of a distance, but past those warehouses, it looks like some newer construction, yet even more warehouses seem to be going up.
Wow, surface people seem to really build a lot of stuff. Do you build buildings?
Really, but, I mean, progress, right? Or I guess maybe not where you're from?
We mostly use seaweeds and stuff to make our clothes and coral and things to make our weapons, so... Yeah, this is pretty new.
Did you want to maybe look around? If we can't find work on the sea, we can find work.
Yeah, I'm up for anything. I heard that there's a festival going on. We could check that out, too.
Celebrating what? What are we...
You know, I didn't ask.
I mean, a festival's always a good time. I have no qualms. Maybe we can win some competitions, earn some cash that way.
Oh, you're going to be perfect for this. And Lobu's going to, like, kind of, like, inappropriately grab your bicep. Be like, they've got an arm wrestling competition.
Oh, that's perfect. I'm going to get a big, like, big, kind of scary-looking smile on my face. I'm always one for the shows of strength.
And maybe we can stack the odds in your favor a little bit.
Bex, do not chew on that. It's a power cord. How about you roll a strength check right now, Emily?
Can I try and give Bardic inspiration to that? Is Roll 20 acting funny?
I was checking. I reloaded my Roll 20 just in case. Yeah, if you guys don't see anything, you might want to try reloading your Roll 20 as well.
Do that.
Oh, I see. Now he's trying to eat my hair.
My,
no, go ahead.
My roommate has a cat who I pet.
Your roommate has a cat that lets you pet it, okay.
Yeah, there are four cats in my house. I'm allergic to most of them, but I love them.
Oh no.
Somebody on Twitch chat, your dog has to roll 1d20 to see if the power cord attack lands, and if it doesn't, hits die of 4d10 of lightning damage. Anyone have a dog? My neighbors have
no dogs.
I live in a nice little condo building. Cool chat. Cat and dog. I just have the two cats. And a fish. You can also, if you know how to use it, roll here on Discord and see what the number pops up. Just like, you know, roll a 1d20 in the general chat or something.
Sure, I could do that.
So the use of sidekick is, it's good for that and good for downtime activities. Like, if you notice, the on-the-road boards keep lighting up. That's because there's a lot of downtime activities between games. Ooh, a 23. Oh yeah, she is very strong. Your bicep just flexes and your hand is nearly thrown free of it.
I think we're about to make a bunch of money.
I think so too. Let's go, friend.
What was your name again?
You can call me Volan if you like.
I'd like to very much.
And I'll put my hand out. What about you?
Name's Lobu.
Lobu.
You don't... Do you speak Elvish at all?
No.
Cool.
Does it mean something in Elvish?
Oh. Yeah. Alright, on to the festival.
Okay.
As you might remember, the festival is actually being set up today and will be on tomorrow. But, as you, you know, head down that way, you do see a couple of job boards, with postings. People looking for various employment. There is one, the family of Owland is looking for people to work on their fishing boat. There is an advertisement looking for people who wish to join the guards. There's another short-term, some sort of short-term work, though it's not specified, to go talk to Gellan Primewater. There's an advertisement saying, come join the miners! Talk to Ministrad Copperlux. And, of course, there's general advertisements looking for people willing to help load and unload ships, and to talk to Anders Solmar to join the actual trading company. Solmar.
Lobu kind of, like, excitedly jumps up and down and is like, we should do this fishing one. I've got, like, an inside line on.
An inside line?
I've got a spell. It's really good.
I mean, I'm not opposed. There's nothing that's standing out to me, so I'd be happy to. Unless, of course, you're interested in this very, very vague job posting. And I'll point to the short-term one.
He kind of leans in and looks at it, and he's like, well, that is extremely mysterious, and I love a good mystery. We should maybe check it out before we do the easy one.
I'm interested.
So, who are we supposed to contact for that one?
Gellan Finewater.
And then Lobu just, like, turns to the next person who's walking remotely close to them and is like, do you know Gellan?
Somebody stops and kind of looks at you. Gellan? Primewater? She's the most prominent of merchants here on the salt marsh. I imagine you'll find him in his office at this hour. And they just kind of point towards a kind of large building in what used to be the older part of the pier.
Thanks, stranger. You want to hang out later?
The stranger just gives you a weird look and hurries on.
I'll kind of place my arm on his elbow. Are you always like this?
I'm not sure. New to town.
Oh, that's All right. I'll let it go, and then I'm just... We should probably head that direction.
Yeah. And then I play accordion along.
Oh.
Roll another performance check for me, please. Alright. So people are actually... Are stopping and listening and kind of nodding. And as you pass, you actually end up with 5 silver, dropped into your hands. As you make your way,
I'm gonna bet.
Make your way over to the merchant office. As you get in,
I'm gonna bet this on the arm wrestling competition tomorrow.
You're betting on me, of course.
Of course.
So, as you get in and ask about Gellin, you are directed to a large office at the back and allowed to go right in. Behind a rather stylish desk made of some, you know, very rich and fancy wood, and, you know, covered with a couple of interesting knickknacks, mostly sea-related, like, you know, a ship in a bottle. Looks like a well-used but well-taken-care-of sextant in a little, you know, little pedestal type of thing. You see a dapper older gentleman with a neatly trimmed beard and a fancy wardrobe. He smiles a little at you, though he looks you both up and down with a little bit of surprise, although he then focuses his eyes more towards the half-orc. Ah, I take it you are here about my posting.
I am, we are.
And what is your name?
I go by Volin, and I'll hold my hand out. Volin Yen.
Alright.
Oh, you must be, Gellin Finewater?
Gellin Finewater, yes.
It's nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you, and he, you know, takes his hand and, you know, shakes it gently. I do have a number of interests around here. How about you tell me a little bit of, your background, and I will see if I have a good position for you.
I spent some time on the sea. I'm currently just looking for some work. Anything involved heavy lifting or things of that nature. I'm very...
And what sort of business have you done on the sea?
Mercenary work mainly, but also distributing resources to other places.
That's always a noble thing to do. I am in a similar business to that. I always like to see that goods are distributed where they need to go. How about your last job on the sea? What was that like?
Last job. It involved transporting things to the west with pirates, so too well.
Oh, what exactly happened?
I'm sorry?
You said not too well, so he is asking what happened as a result.
Well, we were over on those of us that managed dispersed, and I'm here.
You're kind of dropping, I'm afraid. Your mic.
My mic's dropping?
Yeah, so I'm only getting like every other word.
Just essentially the pirates.
It's essentially pirates and then nothing. About this is just session zero, so it's more like, you know, an introductory
thing. Okay.
Getting you guys to know some things of your own, and then we'll figure out, like, you know, you know, hopefully for some other people wants to join, like, you know, I'll do a session zero with them and figure out what they're going to do. But for this one, it's like, okay, so I'm gonna assume that you basically told him that the pirates damaged your last voyage and that pirates are bad, that sort of thing.
Yeah, that's completely that, pretty much.
So he nods a bit and waves you forward, mostly you. He's pretty much ignoring poor Lobu. He's kind of assuming that you, the mighty half-orc with the big muscles, is the one in charge, and he's just, you know, maybe your assistant.
Oh no.
So, I think Lobu, like, runs up to the desk, props his arms to make, like, the triangle, you know, elbow, grasping his face in both hands, and he's like, I'm from under the sea.
Isn't that precious?
I thought so.
He gives a little look, but mostly, again, focuses on Volan. Now, I think I might have a job for you, then.
Ears.
Well, what do you know about Anders Solmor?
Anders Solmor. I know that he's involved in trading.
Well, he recently inherited the business from his mother, who died under mysterious circumstances. He also earned himself a place on the council. I have a feeling that he is up to no good. He's been making some interesting money with his ships. I think, and he leans a little forward conspiratorially towards Volan, I think it's possible he has contacts with the pirates. That maybe his mother found out that what he was doing behind her back, and he did something to her. Now he can run these things unchecked.
Looking at him tell a story, do I believe that?
Roll an insight check.
Sure. Should I roll it in the general chat? Because I rolled it in Roll 20,
yeah.
But I don't know if it should. Okay, yeah.
For some reason, I don't see you in Roll 20. It's just me and Lobu in the game. So I don't know what's going on.
Oof.
Yeah, he seems perfectly believable. You don't have any reason to doubt his story.
Alright. And what was it you wanted us to do about this?
Well, I'm hoping you might find some way, and that this time you actually looked over at Lubu a little bit, of maybe getting some information from him, or perhaps his place. Some proof that he is linked with these pirates, or at very least with the death of his mother. Either one will remove him from power and make sure he can't deal with the pirates anymore.
I'm curious, though. Why about this of going to higher authority?
Well, see, he's on the council, and I've always wanted a seat on the council. They seem to think that my claim is ludicrous, that I just, you know, want a seat. But I have my suspicions, and I think that you might be in a position to help.
I'll turn to Lobu. What do you think about this?
Seems a little fishy, honestly. But, how much you paying?
As much as 50 gold. How does that sound?
50 gold? I'm sorry, but do you want us to, a member of the High Council? I'm going to have to...
I think you dropped off again. I couldn't hear. Sorry.
50 gold seems a little, light for, to find information. A member of the High Council.
City Council.
Low boost. Low boost starts like kind of like tugging on her shirt and is like, it's kind of a lot of money.
I'm sure our employer could do better.
And how much would you say is fair?
In at least 100 gold each.
100 gold for the both of you. How about that? That'd be 50 gold each instead of 50 gold. For
to pay us 50 gold total.
Yes, initially, but perhaps 50 gold each suits you.
Lobu's kind of like trying real hard not to throw his new friend under the boat. So I think he ends up jumping up on the desk and is like, yeah, we want, and then he looks back at her and he's like, we want more to persuade.
All right,
well,
persuasion. No, I would say that 50 gold is for each of you is very fair. Of course, and then he leans forward again. If you do manage to get into his place and, let's say, something went missing, I will not turn you in for it.
He wheels around and is like, let's do it.
Oops. I'll nod.
And then Lobu reaches his fishy little hand down and tries to shake the hand of Volin. No,
Galen, yeah. He carefully puts his hand in yours and begins to shake. Very good. Hopefully you will have me this information by the end of the week.
Yep, we're a great team, and we'll always come out on top. You'll hear from us before the end of the week.
Excellent.
Where's this guy live?
And Galen gives you general directions to how to find Anders, the Solmar house. So, is there anything else the two of you would like to accomplish for a short session zero today? Any other questions about your characters, about the world in general?
I have a few questions. General politics of the region now, like what it's like now.
This particular region, the country of Kielan. Is a monarchy. This particular fishing village was actually only acquired much more recently by the country in general. Let me see. There's actual time limit on this. I was reading over this last night and I've already forgotten. I wrote down some poignant notes. Okay, so basically. This has happened within the last few years. I'm going to say, until I see otherwise, it's been within the last 10 years that the kingdom has essentially acquired Saltmarsh. That before that, Saltmarsh was mostly an independent village, and it was, you know, raided by pirates every once in a while. You know, they found some ways of keeping the peace, but, you know, they were kind of happy when the kingdom decided to come in, acquire them, and, you know, finally protect the land. And they, you know, allowed the power structure in the town, in the village itself, to remain intact. And, you know, the village is prospering from it. As you said, you've seen evidence that several new piers have been built. There's some more, some more warehouses. The rest of it, you don't know yet, because you're new to this village as it is. So those are things you'll need to find out more in character.
Alright, cool.
In terms of the region in general, you probably are somewhat familiar with the Kingdom of Keeland. You know, humans, dwarves, humans are a lot of the power base at the moment. You know, occasionally gnomes, halflings, and elves. Occasional lizard folk, because they're still around from the old empire, from 2,000 years ago. But a lot of lizard folk have kind of, you know, gone back to the swamps, as it were, and left the civilization behind. But that doesn't mean there aren't the occasional descendants of the old, more civilized lizard folk.
Hey, cool.
Yeah, basically, you know mostly that King Scotty has decreed that pirates must be put down, the sea lane secured, and trade cultivated. And that is the main thing that you would know. Which I imagine that Lobu wouldn't, simply because he's, you know, a foreigner in this land.
Right.
Seas out from the west, and the pirates, for the most part, haven't really bothered too much of the under-the-water crowd. He's had more problem dealings with the Shingali? I can never pronounce it properly. Anything else?
I think the only thing Lobu wants to get up to is probably finding a day job as a fisherman.
Be talking to the Owlland, the Owland people, I believe. Yeah, one of the families in town. All right. Yeah, because they're the ones hiring for a fishing boat, and that'll be useful during the week, when you're not either at the festival or dealing with this investigation that you've been handed. You'll be able to make some money off of that. Anything else I can interest you, the two of you, in for question wise?
I think I'm good. I'll send the backstory sometime this week. Would you mind if I send it to you and make sure everything's all right? Like, yeah. Okay. Cool. Thank you very much.
You're most welcome, and welcome to the group here. Yeah. Turn off broadcast.